Hello, everybody, and welcome to the unofficial AGR podcast.
In today's episode, I'm going to be interviewing Nate Kirkpatrick, otherwise known as Deuce Jetson, and playing some songs. So stay tuned. If you have any ideas of stuff that we can do on the podcast, then please comment them below. And if you want to join the AGR podcast and be a guest on it, then please DM AGR podcasts to get in. Sit back, man. Relax, man. Sit back, man. Your eyes are open, so never close them. You'll sail the ocean, finding where you should be. And if you're broken, you'll make your own thing. You'll make it so big for all the world to see. You'll make it so damn big for all the world to see.
Scared to drop this album. Let's push it back another week. I wanna be next up forever. Find a way to never hit my peak. I kinda wish I was still a virgin. Time to finally see what sex is like. I wanna be next up forever. Forever I'll be second in line. Someday they'll be talking about me. Right now they're just walking around me. My God, are you growing without me? Somebody help me. Somebody help me. Someday they'll be talking about me. Right now they're just walking around me. My God, are you growing without me? Somebody help me. My imagination, this is how it looks and sounds. But I gotta go so much bigger, so they can never shut me down. I'm kinda scared of graduation, cause who am I when this is done? I wanna be next up forever, so the best is always yet to come. Someday they'll be talking about me. Right now they're just walking around me. My God, are you growing without me? Somebody help me. Somebody help me. Someday they'll be talking about me. Right now they're just walking around me. My God, are you growing without me? Somebody help me. I gotta go so much bigger, so everybody's proud of me. Welcome to the Neo Theater. Won't everybody take their seats? And I'll be next up forever, cause I don't know what's coming next. I know I gotta grow up sometime, but I don't think I'm ready yet. But I'm not fucking ready.
That was Next Up Forever by AJR. And right now I am joined with Nate Kirkpatrick, otherwise known as Juice Jetson. For those who do not know, he is also JJ Kirkpatrick, the trumpet player's brother. Welcome.
Thank you. Thanks for having me. You know, I really appreciate it.
Yeah, I appreciate you being here, man. So I don't really think it's very fun to get right into the questioning, you know, the cold hard facts. So I think we're gonna play a little bit of a game real quick.
Okay.
This is going to be the 1 minute question game. I'm gonna ask you a bunch of questions that are very random and have no rhyme or reason, and you're just gonna give me all the answers that you can.
Oh boy. Okay.
Alright. Alright. So your minute starts now. What is your spirit animal?
Panther.
If you can jump on stage with any band or artist tomorrow, who would it be?
AJR, of course.
Any bands that you are a little embarrassed that you listen to?
Any bands? Let's see. I was a really big Carly Rae Jepsen fan back in the day. I don't know why. I just really liked her. So.
What is one thing that you wish you had invented?
Snapchat.
What is your Sunday afternoon guilty pleasure movie?
Devil Wears Prada.
All right, 14 seconds left. Song you have most on repeat?
Let's see.
All right, just skip. Strangest Phobia.
Strangest Phobia. I get centipedes down at my place, and I'm, like, terrified of them.
All right, well, that was 1 minute. So you have your own music band, right? Just Juice Jetson is your stage name?
Yeah, it's not a band. It's a solo artist.
Solo artist, right, yeah. How did you come up with the stage name Juice Jetson? Like, what was the inspiration for that?
Well, I used to be Nate the Great was my name. a few years ago, but I there was like, I don't know, I just didn't feel like it was really, really original enough, and like pretty much everyone named Nate ends up with the nickname Nate the Great, so I like,
yeah,
something different. And then I was just like playing around with names. I really liked Jetson because I like, I don't know if you watch the cartoon, just like outer space. I just kind of liked the imagery behind that, and then I just kind of like came up with Juice. And then, you know, I realized, like, the initials were JJ, you know, like my brother, who's always, like, so it was kind of, like, a tribute to him, because I started recording music because of him. I used to take his old MacBook computer, and he had GarageBand on it and stuff, and I would just, like, take it and, like, record, like, little songs on it just through, like, the built-in, like, microphone. Yeah, it was just kind of the JJ part was, yeah, just kind of a tribute to him, because I wouldn't have been started doing music if it wasn't for him.
Okay, so that's awesome. So you started music because of him. Was he always, like, a trumpet player, or did he do other music before?
Yeah, you know, I actually used to play the trumpet, too, and we...
Oh, wow.
Yeah, he's 2 years older than me, but we both started at the age 7. Yeah, so he's always played the trumpet. I mean, the trumpet's like always been a part of his life. So he didn't play any other instruments, you know, he just played trumpet.
And how about you? Did you play any other instruments, or did your like parents play any instruments?
Yeah, we have a really, really musical family. Our dad, he plays, I mean, he sings, he plays guitar, he plays like percussion and drums and stuff. So we've been exposed to music. Like, we were exposed to music like right away in our life. It's just always been around.
Yeah, started off young.
Mm-hmm.
So you guys, you and JJ and even your parents, you guys like practice together, you guys jam together?
Yeah, a little bit. My mom doesn't really play. She has like a good musical ear, but she never played an instrument, but...
Oh, okay. And so with your music, it's more like hip-hop, I would say. Like, how would you describe your music?
Yeah, I'd say more hip-hop, like R&B kind of stuff.
Okay, yeah. Because what I find interesting about you and JJ and everybody like in AJR is that you guys all have, like, a variety of music tastes, a very, like, big genre. Like, you guys like pretty much like everything.
I feel like that's kind of how you have to be as a musician. You kind of have to have an open mind and kind of respect all like different genres of music and like take what you can from it and, you know, kind of get inspired by it. I feel like that's really important.
Yeah. otherwise you kind of fall into this like certain hole where you can't dig yourself into other places and you kind of just repeat yourself a lot.
Yeah, or you're just putting out stuff that's just the same sound, you know, over and over and over. Because I like always try to like branch out and like try new stuff, and I feel like that's, you know, pretty important. And AJR, you know, they're really big on that, which I really respect about them.
Yeah, speaking of AJR, do you remember your first interaction with AJR, like when you first met them? Was it like backstage or just like out to dinner, you guys, like something like that?
Yeah, well, I met them at for the first time at the Portland show. I actually still, I haven't formally met Ryan yet, but I met Adam first. I was at the Portland show and they're like doing the sound check and stuff. And then like I just like walked off and he was like backstage and we, you know, we chatted for a minute. Really, really, really nice guy. Took a picture together and stuff. And
oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, just really, really, really nice guy. And then I met Jack. I met Jack for the first time, and I was wearing, I don't know if you saw my my shirt that said AJJR.
Oh yeah, yeah. I remember I was watching the AJR documentary, and I was like, "Whoa, that's such a cool shirt!" And I was actually gonna ask you about that and like why you decided to do that, because that's, I found that really cool.
Yeah, so I was wearing that shirt when I saw Jack backstage, and you know, he definitely got a kick out of it. And he was really nice about it too. The funny thing is like my brother told me, like when I was at the sound check, he told me not to wear the shirt to sound check because he thought it was just gonna like draw too much attention, which it definitely would have. So I wore something different, and then after the sound check, I like changed into it. Yeah, so when I met Jack, we like pretty much talked about that, and then, you know, we chatted it up for a little bit, and that was pretty much it. They were busy and they had a lot going on, so I didn't have a chance to, you know, hang out and talk to them too much. But
yeah, I can imagine.
Really nice guys, and it was cool to finally get to meet them.
Yeah, that's awesome. So with your shirt, did anyone like recognize you as yourself or as JJ's brother, or did anybody say anything about the shirt like after the show?
Oh my god, it was ridiculous because he like pointed me out like you saw in the documentary. So for the people that didn't see it, Jack was talking and then they were shouting out JJ, just that he was in his hometown and stuff. And then he was like, "Your brother's here too, isn't he?" And then Ezra, the light guy, I don't know how he knew where I was. Right after he said that, the lights went directly on me.
I did see something, and I think I need JJ's help for this, by the way. By the way, guys, JJ is native to Portland. This is his hometown. City, if I'm not mistaken, is that your brother?
And he's like, "Oh, there he is up there." And then I'm like up there, like, you know, going crazy, of course. Jumping up and down with the lights on me, and like the whole crowd like turns around and looks at me.
And it says AJJR. Yes.
Yeah, and then Jack's like, "I don't know if you see, he decided to make his own merch."
Honestly, if that was made into merch, I would totally buy that. Like, not even kidding.
Yeah, and then Jack was like, "Yeah, this is pretty cool, but it doesn't have my face on it though, so I don't know."
My face isn't on there, so that's already a problem.
Yeah. Well, technically, it has two J's, so it could be Adam, Jack, Ryan. So.
Yeah. That's true. That's how I look at it too. But I had, yeah. But what I was saying is after that, like when I was walking like backstage, I had to go like against the grain. Like everybody was walking one direction. You had to walk like the other way, like to get past them. And just like everybody like recognized me and stuff. And like people like stopping to take pictures with me. It was actually like crazy. I felt like a celebrity.
Okay. So going off the AJR documentary, another thing that I saw in the AJR documentary was that JJ was talking about how one time, I believe he was put into summer school and he had trumpet lessons after school. And he told a story of how he had to hide his trumpet during summer school,
like hid it behind a trash can, like,
really,
and halfway through class, like the principal of the summer school comes in and is like, "JJ, I want to talk to you in my office." And I go into his office and he like holds up my trumpet. He's like, "What is this, man? Like, what do you know you left this?" And I was like,
"Yeah,
you should be proud of this. Like,
wow,
this is the thing that's gonna make you cool. Like,
no,
everybody else
shit.
Here is lame. You, like, this is what is gonna be.
Wow,
it's gonna make you cool."
Yeah. You know, he wasn't like kind of proud of it. And like back then, you know, like middle school and high school kids, like, they're so mean, and, like, of course, the kids in the band aren't usually, like, the cool kids. Yeah, so I don't know, he just never liked to really tell people that he played music and never really wanted to show it off, and he was, like, I mean, he'll tell you this himself, he was, like, kind of in a way, like, embarrassed of it, which is, like, sad to think about, you know, but he's still, like, stuck with it, and now he's, like, the coolest guy in the world, you know?
Yeah, for sure.
But yeah, he definitely had a lot of that where he didn't want people to know he was a musician because he didn't think it was quote unquote cool, you know?
Yeah, I find that really sad. Like, especially for anyone that has any sort of talent in middle school or high school, and especially high school, people just don't like people with talent for some reason. They just find anybody that are better than them threatening, and they just want to, like, bring them down to their own level.
Yeah. And he also had a lot of issues because he was actually a really good, or is, you know, he's a really good athlete, and he always played sports, but he had sports and music kind of, like, had a lot of conflicts. There's a lot of times, like, on Saturdays he would like supposed to have a football game, but he'd have to go to, like, music, do, like, you know, go to band or go to a rehearsal or something instead.
Yeah.
My parents would always make him choose, like, music. Like, music would always be a priority over, like, you know, football or sports or whatever. And as a kid, you know, he hated that because he kind of, like, preferred to be doing sports. Because, you know, that was the cool thing to do. So he had a lot of issues with that, too.
Yeah, I'm surprised by that because, like, most of the people I talk to, or most of the parents I talk to about their kids or anything like that, a lot of the time they always, like, try to focus on sports and their kids being athletic and stuff. So I'm surprised that your parents mainly focused on the music side of it.
Yeah, me too, actually, because we just, like, we have a really musical family. We have a really athletic family, too. Like, my dad, he played, I mean, he was All-American for football in high school, and then he played college football at Purdue. And our older brother Tony, we have different moms but the same dad. He played football at Washington for the Washington Huskies. So yeah, that's true. You know, we were always, like, encouraged to do sports, but I think just for him, like, my parents were able to see more potential in his music than in sports.
Especially football.
Yeah, especially football. And then JJ, he'll tell you himself, like, if it wasn't for my mom, you know, he'll use the word forcing him to go to trumpet lessons and stuff like that, he wouldn't be where he is today.
Yeah, get in the car, let's go, we're going to trumpet.
Yeah, so there was one time, like, because he would fight them about, you know, going to rehearsal sometimes. One time he was supposed to have a basketball game, and my mom just didn't want to fight with him, so she, like, let him get in his basketball uniform. And instead of taking him to the game, she took him to his he snuck his trumpet in the back and took him to his trumpet lesson.
That's sneaky. That's smart.
He came home and he was so pissed. I'll never forget that. That's funny.
So with your, like, dad being so musical, was he ever, like, in a band or anything like that?
Yeah, he's currently in a band. He plays percussion and drums right now in a band, and they do, like, a lot of, like, Afro-Cuban stuff. It's not like they're traveling doing tours or anything like that, but but they do some local gigs sometimes, and they actually have a pretty talented group. They have another percussionist who was actually me and JJ's Spanish teacher in middle school, and he's super talented, and they have some pretty cool stuff that they do.
Well, that's really interesting, especially with the Spanish teacher joining in.
Yeah, right.
Where do you hope your music career, like, takes you, like, as Juice Jetson?
I don't know, I kind of have, so my career, I work at the juvenile detention here in Portland. So I went to school for criminal justice. That's, like, what I have my degree in. So, like, I consider, like, that my career, and my music for me is more like
a hobby.
Yeah, it's more something I do for fun, and it's not really, like, it's not like I'm, like, sitting here, like, dependent on, like, it blowing up and, like, that being my career. As, like, as cool as that would be, I'd say it's more, yeah, it's more like a hobby for me at this point.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, but I still, you know, still take it serious. Like, I've been trying to do some, like, studio time for people where they, like, you know, they'll, like, pay me to, like, mix their songs for them and stuff. So as of now, you know, it's more just, like, kind of just a hobby for me.
Do you have any other like particular hobbies that you find as fun as, or maybe even more fun as, music?
No, music's like, that's like just my number one.
Like, even I have just so much music that I've just made that I've just never put out, you know, but I just, fills a void in my life trying to record stuff and make songs. It's just like really important to me.
For those who have not like had a chance to listen to your music, what song would you like ask them to listen to if you wanted them to like get into it?
Yeah, I have a song called Genie that I made probably about a year old now. When I put that song out, I feel like I got like the most positive
feedback from it. Yeah.
I've been meaning to do like a music video for it or something, just to kind of get it out there more.
Any ideas on like what you think that would be, the music video?
Not really, to be completely honest. I've been back and forth on ideas. Yeah, but I'd say that, and that's also like one of my favorite songs too, and it's like really personal to me, because it was, I got divorced. I don't know, I just can kind of like feel like my pain and like my emotion like in that song. So like it just like kind of really means a lot to me. So that's definitely always been probably my favorite song of mine.
Well, I'm really sorry about that.
Oh, no, it's okay. It was, you know, it's life, and I have, you know, a lot of support and people that like help me get through it, you know, so I'm doing good.
Yeah, it's good. Especially because like you can use music as like a way to cope with that.
Yeah, that's exactly what I do. It's a really important support piece for me.
And for anybody listening, if you guys want to go check him out, go down in the description and click on his channel. Listen to all his music. He's actually a really good musician. So, besides JJ, because of course he's your brother, who would you consider like your favorite person of the band to be, or like the person you like connected most with?
That's a good question. Yeah, like I said, I really liked Adam. He was just a really nice guy. We had a quick talk. A lot of my family came to the show. I have like little cousins and stuff, and he was really nice to everybody. He was really nice to my mom, and he was like, you know, taking pictures with everybody. And we were all taking a family picture, and he came over and was, you know, offered to be the one to take the photo for us and stuff. And it was just like a really, like, really friendly guy. I just feel like he just has like a good like vibe about him.
Yeah, he sounds really nice, and he seems really nice, especially with how much like how big they are on politics and stuff, because a lot of bands try not to get into that so they don't like lose followers. But what I found with AGR is like, they just really don't give a crap, and they just will do whatever they want to push their views and how they think the world should be, like, become a better place.
I mean, like, the AJR fandom is, like, the most loyal fan base I've ever seen in my life. I don't think they could, like, do anything to lose.
Yeah. All right, so I think we're probably about wrapping it up. I want to ask you, like, two more questions. These are questions from some AGR fans that want to ask you a couple questions. First off, from Handle Life Gives You Lemons, question is, what was your brother's process in becoming a part of the band?
That's a good question. So he wasn't doing what he's doing now, but he was still doing like little gigs, you know, some jazz stuff, but he wasn't doing anything I don't think he was all like that fired up about. Actually, one of his best friends, Jake, who lives in New York, is friends with Adam, and Jake actually referred Adam to JJ. So they reached out to him and asked him to come on tour with them. And I honestly hadn't even heard of AJR. I hadn't heard any of their songs or anything like that. So when he told me, he's like, I'm touring with this new band, AJR. I just assumed it was like some little jazz band or something. I really checked them out and saw like how big and popular they were, and I just was like, wow, this is gonna be a huge opportunity for him.
So like, what album did he start playing with them? Like, was it during the Click? Because I remember seeing him in Role Models.
Yeah, so he started on the Click tour. So that was about a year ago, last March.
Oh, okay. Second question. This is from Potato Lord. Which AGR song do you connect with most and why?
I've always liked 100 Bad Days, just because like my brother, he was here in town, and he actually showed me that song like way like months and months before it actually came out. That was one of the first songs I feel like where he had like a really big like trumpet
monumental part. Yeah,
yeah, just thank you, that's a great way to decide it. Yeah, like a monumental part, and I didn't see it coming at all. I actually recorded a video of it. It's pretty funny. Remember when we
we all got drunk. I ended up with two broke thumbs. Oh my god, I felt so dumb. Lucky me. When all is coming wrong and you're scared as hell. What you gonna do? Who you gonna tell? Maybe a 100 bad days made 100 good stories. Hey. 100 good stories make me interesting at parties. My favorite song. I loved it very much. I made the song my alarm.
Like, this is still rough.
I ain't hearing it ever anymore. I'm not anymore. I don't wanna be bored. I used to be distracted, rolling around in the dirt. But recently, I'm thinking about my purpose on earth.
But he just like casually like sits down like, yeah, here's this new song like we're putting out. And then like it just like blew me away when like the trumpet comes in at the end, like just like hearing that for the first time, it was just like insane. And I just knew like how it was gonna blow up and how like just how everybody was gonna love it. And that's like exactly what happened.
I remember listening to that song, and at first I was like, this is a very strange thing for AGR, but I soon realized that, of course, it was going to be the beginning of, like, their entire sound of their new album. And then as soon as it got to the screw your thing, it goes like this, that drop, and I heard the... I specifically actually heard the trumpet, and I was like, oh my god, this is amazing. It, like, blew my mind.
And the cool part, like, the story behind it is they just, like, sent him, like, a little vocal clip. I think Ryan was just singing, like, the little... you know, just like a little clip of what they wanted. And I guess like 15, 20 minutes later, he laid down like just like a bunch of tracks and just like killed it, you know, and like just immediately sent it right back to them. So I just like imagine like what their reaction was to it, like when they got that back. It was probably just like blew them away.
All right. Well, thank you so much for joining me on this. If you guys want to check out him and his music, the link will be in the description. And I'm also going to play his song Genie right now. Other than that, thank you guys so much for joining me. And I'll see you on the next podcast.